I'm pleased at this time to introduce our first panel leader, Dr. Antoinette Tony Zeiss, as we know her. She worked in the Veterans Administration hospital system for over 30 years and ended up being the acting lead and then eventual lead in the leadership of that organization. Prior to her work in the Veterans Administration system, she taught at Arizona State University and at Stanford University, and is a leading advocate for mental health services in the VA. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Antoinette Zeiss.
And Barry, one small thing. Yeah, it's the Department of Veterans Affairs. It's a hard change in this country. Until 1989, it was the Veterans Administration, and lots of people went through training, learned. It became, you know, in their minds, Veterans Administration. But in 1989, we became the Department of Veterans Affairs, a cabinet level program in the United States government, and provide an integrated model of care across the country. It's really my pleasure to be here today and to be a part of this incredible conference. Barry, this is terrific. And I'm going to speak just super briefly because I'm going to just introduce you to these three wonderful panelists who will be talking about international models of integrated care. And they have brief times to talk, so I want to get out of the way as fast as I can. They'll each be speaking for 10 minutes, and then I will pose a question for the panel. It's a question that will be posed to each panel, I believe, as we go through the program. And then there may be time for follow-up questions, either one that I might pose or if there are questions from the audience. So very eager to hear both your presentations and what you can add as we have interaction. And I'm going to introduce all three speakers now so that you can then just follow each other smoothly. The first speaker will be Dr. Pamela Collins, who's Associate Director for Special Populations and Director of the Office for Research on Disparities in Global Mental Health and the Office of Rural Mental Health Research at the U.S. National Institute of Mental Health, NIMH. She currently oversees NIMH's research efforts to increase mental health equity locally and globally. And her office supports a portfolio of research projects focused on integrating mental health into various platforms of care in low and middle income communities. And she does lots more than that, and there's a more lengthy bio in your materials, but again, I'm going to speed through this. Dr. Xulin Chen works in China and has an MD and PhD from universities in China. And he also did a postdoctoral training in Rochester here in the US under the mentorship of Professor Yates Conwell, who's here with us today also, with special emphasis on theoretical groundwork and research methodology for studying collaborative care approaches to detection and treatment of late life depression. And he's been awarded an R01 grant from NIH to examine the effectiveness of the intervention on late life depression in urban clinics. And he's also doing extensive work throughout China in exploring models of integrated care. And Dr. Tor Hofgaard, who will be our third speaker, is president of the Norwegian Psychological Association. And he is also vice president of the International Union for Psychological Science, which represents over 80 psychology associations around the world. He's in the executive council of the European Federation of Psychologists Association, which represents 36 member associations in Europe. He's chair of the board for the Norwegian Council for Mental Health, and he has degrees both in psychology from the University of Oslo and in political science. So we have a very knowledgeable and distinguished panel for you today. And let me invite Dr. Collins up to get us started.
Oops. So how do I get my presentation? Okay. So thank you very much, Tony. It's a real pleasure to be here, and I really appreciate the invitation. I think my introduction to this area of integrating mental health started about 20 years ago, working in the Argentine Patagonia in a province called Neuquén, which had a very strong primary health care system, but a small number of mental health specialists scattered across the province. And we worked to figure out how to enable primary care doctors to work better with the mental health system and to be able to manage some of the chronic mental illnesses on their own. And some of the challenges were interdisciplinary communication. How do you talk to each other? But also, how do you clarify what are the roles of primary care in this kind of context, particularly in a rural area where there are limited resources and not easy access to tertiary care services? And I think these are some of the problems that persist as we try to figure out how to integrate care. But solving these problems is incredibly important. And I'm going to just make the case for why it's important and talk a bit about some examples from NIMH about what we've been doing in this area. So I don't have to tell all of you, but you know that as a group, mental disorders are the leading causes of disability globally. And major depressive disorder ranks second globally in terms of causes of disability. But when you look at individual countries and regions of the world, it may fall into first place, even in places where you least expect it. So this is the 2013 global burden of disease data, looking at a swath of countries in sub-Saharan Africa where major depressive disorder is the leading cause of disability, even in a context where infectious diseases are still a source of high mortality. Again, these are sections of the Caribbean and Andean Latin America. Again, major depressive disorder comes in as a leading cause of disability. And despite this, as we heard from Dr. Holder, insufficient financing, a dearth of mental health care resources impact access to care in many low and middle income country contexts. So, for the last 15 years, certainly since the 2001 World Health Report, the WHO has been calling for integration of mental health into primary care, acknowledging this very significant burden. This is, again, just to show you that anxiety disorders come in as number three in many Latin American countries. But disability is not our only concern in the context of looking at mental health care. These disorders frequently co-occur, and they frequently occur with other medical conditions, often worsening morbidity and mortality for these conditions. Interestingly, if you happen to see the October 2015 Lancet issue, which showed a very nice analysis of, again, 2010 data from the global burden of disease, they found that with depression alone, more than 2.2 million excess deaths are associated with major depression alone. So that's not even looking at the range of mental disorders. We also know that targeting treatment for mental disorders can improve other health outcomes. So one example is treating depression leads to better cardiovascular outcomes. Management of mental disorders in primary care or other priority healthcare settings enables holistic care, as we heard. And of course, utilizing a non-specialist settings can extend the availability of the mental health workforce. So many of the countries that we are focusing on, at least in the context of my office, have very few mental health care providers. So figuring out how do you use non-specialists is critical. And these non-specialist care settings can be more acceptable and are often less attached to less social stigma. Globally, the Millennium Development Goals, these kinds of global initiatives, have stimulated the development of packages of care that have been successfully used to manage maternal mortality, child mortality, HIV/AIDS, tuberculosis. And these people who've been putting their heads together for the last 15 years really recognize that you have to pursue synergies in the healthcare system in order to bundle packages of care. So how do we do that in mental health? Well, we sought to catalyze attention to mental disorders by convening a global set of stakeholders a few years ago to come to consensus on what are the grand challenges in global mental health. So we launched this initiative in 2010 in order to build consensus in high, middle, and low-income countries on what barriers, if removed, would stand to significantly improve the lives of people with mental disorders. More than 400 people, key stakeholders, clinicians, some advocates, researchers from 60 countries responded to identify 40 grand challenges and 60 grand challenge goals. Those six grand challenge goals included identifying the root causes and risks and protective factors of mental disorders, advancing prevention and implementation, improving treatments and expanding access to care, raising awareness of the global burden, building human resource capacity, and finally, transforming health system and policy responses. And one of those specific challenges was to redesign health systems to integrate mental, neurological, and substance use disorders with other chronic disease care. So this became an initiative that we wanted to address. And as we thought about how mental health could be integrated in the global context, number one, we realized that we had to think beyond primary care to other priority healthcare platforms like maternal child health. We know, of course, the importance of addressing perinatal depression, for example, on both maternal outcomes as well as child outcomes, integrating into HIV care platforms. Again, HIV and mental disorders often comorbid and also with impact for outcomes for both. So we also realized that one way of thinking about this would be to organize this around some of the cross-cutting themes that emerged in the grand challenges. And those included using system-wide approaches, which we just heard about. And that really refers to recognizing that integrated care occurs best when you've got every part of a health system, ranging from the health information systems, to human resources, to financing, to workforce, leadership, and governments, functioning in a coherent fashion, but also recognizing that system-wide approaches also mean collaboration beyond the healthcare system, as someone mentioned in the first discussion, meaning that we need to figure out what are the roles of education, justice, labor, particularly with people for chronic and remitting mental disorders. Understanding, applying evidence-based interventions, we need to ensure that people are using the evidence base. The good news is that for psychological interventions, we now have a substantial global evidence base. It's moving beyond high-income countries to low- and middle-income countries as well. Understanding environmental influences. This both means understanding the social and cultural context of the health system, but also understanding the individual exposures that people come to the health system with, whether that's exposure to war, whether that's exposure to poverty. All of these things need to be taken into account in the system. And finally, using a life course approach was one of the other cross-cutting themes. Recognizing that both physical and social exposures at every stage of life can have influences on health across the lifespan. So again, taking this into account in terms of preventive and treatment interventions in the context of care. Let's see. So what do you integrate? I think our best evidence is around common mental disorders, depression, anxiety, and alcohol use disorders. We put together a series in PLOS Medicine that focused on integrating mental disorders into maternal child care, HIV care, and non-communicable disease care in 2013. And that series focused on these specific disorders because this tended to be where the evidence base was. These are disorders that all utilize psychological and or psychopharmacological interventions. They're amenable to collaborative care approaches. They all have life course implications, and care can be delivered by non-specialists. And what do you do? How does one actually integrate? Well, first, you need to assess goals, functions, and resources of amongst the teams that need to be integrated. What are the goals? What are the shared functions? Who's going to pay for this? One has to identify shared and achievable objectives amongst the teams to be integrated, amongst the systems to be integrated. One has to assign responsibilities and establish a good monitoring mechanism. Specify skill sets available using the available human resources. This is where task shifting has become very important in low and middle income countries, that is, using less specialized providers to deliver care. And finally, using a standardized collaborative care model for which we have a significant evidence base on its efficacy. And some of the remaining needs in low and middle income countries in particular are that we really don't have a great evidence base in these settings. We have evidence in high income countries for integration, but not so much in low and middle income countries. We don't have good examples of scaling up, and yet we know that integration makes sense where health systems need strengthening, and particularly where there is weak health system infrastructure, where there may be weak procurement mechanisms, poor financing, and limited human resources. This is probably a good model for care. I'm just going to tell you in a second about one of our projects, one of our initiatives at NIMH called the Collaborative Hubs for International Health, International Research on Mental Health, which are five hubs, and I'm just going to flash up their abbreviated names here, AFFIRM, Latin MH, the Partnership for Mental Health and Development, PAMD, Ready Americas, and SHARE, the South Asian Hub for Advocacy, Research, and Education, all of which are conducting trials focusing on integrating care into whether it's a maternal and child health platform, primary care, non-communicable disease care, and they're all using task shifting. So with these studies, we'll get a huge boost to the evidence base on task shifting in developing countries. The other thing that we required of applicants in this initiative was that they had to have partners with the local Ministry of Health. They had to have partners with the end users of the research from the beginning so that when these trials are finished, we'll hopefully have a much better chance of public health uptake. This is just one of the maternal child health clinics in Khayelitsha. This is where the counselor sits and talks to the pregnant women who are coming for care. And I also want to mention another initiative that came out of our grant challenges was specifically around integrating care into other platforms. And we have these six activities that are currently underway in Africa and in Asia, and Xu Lin is going to talk about one of those. But these really get at the question that what do we know about managing multiple illnesses? What do we know about cost effectiveness, again, particularly in low and middle income countries? And finally, we are very excited about a new initiative around scaling up interventions in low and middle income countries because we need to learn these models and we need to be able to have an evidence base for applying models for good implementation science to scale up care. And I'm going to stop there.
Keep going. Which button? Is it the one on the right or the bottom?
I don't know. I think it's the one on the right.
Okay.
There it is.
Yeah. It's my honor to be here to talk about my study in China to introduce the integrative care for midlife depression in China. I'm Xu Lingchen, also a psychiatrist. And as a psychiatrist, I'm very interested about how to be accepted in the public. So we think about what we can do for the public mental health. I will talk about the needs of integrative care for late-life depression in China and the resource of the integrative care and the evidence from our current studies and the scale-up in next. Mm-hmm. Okay. I will show the picture about from the right side, the population in China. And as you know, our China government just ended the one-child policy, try to increase the base, the population base. And in the left side is about the mental disorder prevalence among different age group. And the orange bar is means indicates that in the age over 60 years old, the mental disorder prevalence rate is highest. And in the middle is our study. We select one primary community as a study site and screen with PHQ-9 to the depression and follow up them 3 months. And the 1 year natural outcome shows that if one patient have depression, after 1 year, they don't remit. So we think about the depression is very important, and the late life depression is a serious public health issue in China. But as a psychiatrist in China, I have a daily clinic, but I did not see many new patients, older patients to visit me. That's why I don't understand. So in 2006, I moved my practice from the hospital, to the community. And I applied for the NIH Fogarty Center and fellow. So I work with my mentor, Dr. Conway Yates, to think about what kind of model can be used in China to think about the next mental health to be a public mental health. And this strategy in USA and the developed Western country talk about the depression care in primary care, and also talk about the collaborative care models for depression. And I think this paper is very powerful. It talk about it's time to move from evidence to practice in 2006. But I have an idea about what kind of practice to be, in China now. And also in this called Dr. Collins' paper about the integration of mental disorder with chronic disease management. So we think about if this model can be used in China, we can benefit lots of older adults in China. And we think about this model may be possible. So we think about the resource. First, we can see the right side. These are our psychiatrists in the last 10 years. In China, we only have 25,000 psychiatrists, but we service about 1 billion population, more than 1 billion population. in the same time, we can see that picture about the total primary care physician in the last 10 years. Our government increased primary care practice very quickly. And right now, the more than 800,000 primary care physicians in China now. And also with our, the percentage of population aged of over than 65 years in last 10 years, that's crazy. So we think about, can we use the primary physician to do that? Can we use this resource in the community to do something? So we try to use this model to talk about the collaborative care in China to take care of patients with late life depression. The key components is talk about the patient center, and also we think about the primary care is very has a benefit to think about the primary care in the patient center. And also in China, we especially in urban China, many cities have a primary care center. The government set up that and funded all human resource and also their daily function, and also gave them many times to do the public health issue. And in Hangzhou, we have in each neighborhood they have one primary care clinic and at least one doctor and one nurse. And 60% of their time have to do public health issue like health education, like chronic disease management, something like that. So we think about we can use that resource. And the second is the time and the efficient. And so we talk about the common mental disorder follow Collins as the idea of think about not talk about the schizophrenia or bipolar disorder. The psychiatrists talk about the schizophrenia, think it's a major mental health issue, but in the community, many physicians don't think I cannot handle the schizophrenia or bipolar disorder, but I can talk about the insomnia, I can talk about the depression, anxiety. I think that's easy for me. And also we need the evidence-based components. That's our first try to think about the collaborative care in our Chinese primary care center. And also information system is very important. That's in urban system is very easy because many government funding a lot of resource in the computer resource in the community center. So we think about we have resource, we have most of the components ready to do the collaborative care model in China. So this is a current study from China. We adapted the model from the MacArthur Foundation, talk about the depression care management. We assigned, we use a RCT study. We assigned this 16 primary clinics into two different groups. One is the depression care management group, another is a care as usual group. In the depression care management group, we train the physician, use the PHQ-9 with the depression care management treatment guideline. And we also train the primary care nurse as a care manager to do the case management. And also the psycho education. And also we have a psychiatry team to support this physician and the nurse, and also do the communication. And this model published on the Lancet Psychiatry this year, and the effective size is great. After 3 months, most of the patients with late life depression have a great effectiveness. And also follow up them 12 months, the effective is also here. So we think about this model is successful. But this model is to talk about treatment with medication, not to talk about like psycho support or any psychotherapy or social support, something like that. We treat the physician with medication, use the medication to treat the late life depression. But from this model, we see some patients don't like the medication. And they maybe like psychotherapy, and also some physicians also don't like the medication. They think maybe patient want to hear more about like psychotherapy, psych consultation, something like that. So this model gave us a lot of resources to think about what we can do for next. We think about if we want to scale up this model around China or around other low middle income countries, we think about not just about medication or not just about physician, primary care, nurse, something like that. We also need other community resources like to do some community psychosocial support and some behavioral intervention. So we proposed another NIH grant, it's a coach study, to think about to use aging work with the communication with the physician, with the nurse together to think about. Also, we think about in the limited resource in rural China to think about how to integrate the community resource, the physician resource, and also the community center resource together to take care of patients with late life depression. And I also think about not just a psychiatrist to be the support. We think about the psychologist and also talk about the social work. But unfortunately, in China, we don't have any formal training about social work. So I'm thinking about can we use the community resource like aging worker or other like a woman, a very powerful woman in the local villager to we work together to think about the future. So we try to do more. And we want to think about our funding was provided by the US NIMH and also NIH, and also our country new center, excellent tenant in University of China. Thank you.
Hello. I am very honored to be here to talk about and being invited to talk about my job, basically. that's always fun. This is not me. No. This is not me. No. 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 Okay. This talk was much longer, I see. Okay. Here we go. This is not my work. I'm sorry. Oh, there we go. Okay. No. There we go. So, that is not me. That is the politicians. That is what I try to avoid, having politicians stick their head in the sand. And my, as you heard from the introduction, I'm the president of the Norwegian Psychological Association, and I have other things I do as well. But being president of the Norwegian Association is a full-time job. So I'm thankfully, I have a job where I try to get what you do as researchers and what researchers do and translate it into something that politicians can understand. And that job is a full-time job, I can assure you. But what I will talk about today is how we have managed to get the politician from this position to a position that is somewhat different today in the last 8 years. So I will talk about that. The idea was that the Norwegian politicians really did understand after some years that they were actually throwing away the money. They were throwing it away by just building on having secondary care system or building on the hospitals. Everything was going on in the hospitals, even mental health. We had a big plan for mental health in Norway where they wanted to develop good services, and they really did, but it only happened in the hospital. So the only one who got services were the people who had severe problems and not the ones with minor problems. And I think that what changed, I would like to take credit for some of this, but I think what changed was the finance minister actually went to the health ministry and said, you know, now the cost of the hospitals has doubled in 7 years. This cannot continue. And then they had to do something very different. So so that started with, a health reform. This was not one of the slides I had prepared. Well, then we got a healthcare reform. That was very new. It said basically that the hospitals should now be the support service of the municipality services, which was a totally new way of thinking. But this was just a reform saying this is what we want to achieve, and it has to be done. A lot of different things had to be done to get this done. But the thing was, for the first time, it was a reform saying the municipality services, the local services, had to be better, it has to be bigger, and the hospital should support the system and not the other way around. So, mental health was one thing that also happened was that mental health for the first time was given to the municipalities as something they had to deliver. Until then, the hospitals had to deliver mental health services. It said in the law in Norway that that the municipalities had to give the services that the people needed, but no municipalities really interpreted that as they have to give mental health services. So we got a law in Norway specifying that the municipalities had to have mental health services, and not only mental health services, but they had to focus on mental health promotion, mental health prevention, and also early intervention. So the law was very specific, and the parliament actually said, we do mean that the law that was there before also said all these things, but we specify this because mental health obviously was not taken care of in a good way. So mental health grew as something they had to do as well. So the changing, what we actually managed to achieve was the changes of the law that was really important. The mental health law was changed. The law that regulated municipality services was changed. So mental health got very much more specified as something they had to do. And we now also have a law that's coming out next year saying that there must be psychologists in primary care, which is a very new thing. It has never been like this before. There have been psychologists in primary care, of course, and also in school services and everything, but that there must be psychologists in primary care is a very new thing, and there must be in these teams. And now we see, a new white paper came to the Parliament this year saying that we want to have team-based services. They must be integrated, they must be to everyone, and they must include mental health services. And the good thing for these services, I think, was that we have piloted some of this before, so we know something about what to do and how to do this. And what I will talk about, show you today, was the model that we developed for having psychologists in these teams and how that changed. But what will happen in Norway now is that we will get two kind of teams in primary care. One of them will be a primary care team that is consisting of the GPs, the nurses, the psychologists, physiotherapists, social workers. Everyone will be in this team. So when you want to go to, if you have any kind of problem, you go to this team instead of going just to the GP and then be transferred around the system in these different silos. So this primary care team will say, okay, you are in the right place, no matter what you come with, because they have all these professions there. And then we will have follow-up teams that will be teams that are more flexible, that will be for people who come back from the secondary care system that need to be followed up by the primary in the primary care. They will then be followed up by this flexible team that will be put together with the people that they need. And there will also be a team that will consist of people from the secondary team together with the people from the primary care team, and also with the social workers as well. So this is the plan for the future in Norway, which is just out in a white paper. We don't know exactly how these teams will be financed. We don't know exactly how these teams will be staffed and how they will do this and how they will regulate it. But as you probably know, we have a public health system in Norway, so it will be a part of the public health system. So what I will show you now is the pilot we did and what we did with placing psychologists in primary care, because this is the normal model, as you know, for stepped care, which a lot of people have. And in Norway, at least, the referral to psychologists or referral to the secondary care system appeared very late in this step. So what we did was to place the psychologists in teams in primary care. And what happened was, first of all, what happened was that having a psychologist there together with all the others led to a better placing of what the, or better, better play, that the people got into these steps in a better way. And we also saw a reduction, we also see a reduction in this in the referrals to the secondary care system, which is of course the whole idea, to get fewer people to the secondary care system. But what we also saw was that having psychologists there led to less individual intervention and less led to more systemic intervention in schools and families and in the living environment. So instead of just going through these steps individually, people, the psychologists helped these teams and also themselves went into the schools, went into the families and helped there instead of helping individually. And they also supervised the different other professions that were there. And it was interesting when we had the evaluation report from this pilot, all these different professions said it was wonderful to get psychologists into these teams because we could do much more than we did before. And also, the team, having a psychologist there led to an easier way of knowing when you need to send people back to the secondary care system, and then you can also follow them better up with the treatment plan they have. But as you see, this model only shows you how we can treat people better. What we also now want to achieve is to have psychologists actually doing something with the driving forces behind people getting illness. So, and this is health promotion and prevention. And the whole idea is that psychologists should, and also we see this now, the psychologists are going into this kind of work, are doing more local health, public health work, and also doing more reviews and developing action plans. And the whole idea is, of course, that we should have better plans, better society, and less people at risk. So that is the model for psychologists in these teams. And the good thing is that after 8 years, the politicians really want to have this model. Which is really good, and then it's just to get it there. But as I said, we now have a law saying that there must be psychologists in primary care, and this is the psychologist they want to have. It's a psychologist that is not in these silos, but a psychologist that can serve all these different services already and spread their resources into all these different areas. So we will still have psychologists in crisis teams, still have psychologists in schools, but we will then have other psychologists and this kind of psychologist in teams working towards all these services. And I think that this is me with the Minister of Health. And this is, I brought this picture with me because in this meeting, I was actually asked to join the Minister of Health to talk to his political colleagues to tell them why they need psychologists in primary care. So this question about how can we do our political work better as professionals, I think one of the answers to that question is to be more, listen more to what the politician wants to achieve, and then connect what you can contribute to that, instead of saying what I want and what we want as psychologists. And I also think that we should, what he told me once, that he had totally forgotten that I am a psychologist from a psychologist association. He just sees me as a partner in developing Norway, and that is the position we want to be in. But you don't get there by saying we want to be listened to. You have to listen to the politicians. Thank you.
First of all, is this microphone? Okay, good. Well, first of all, I would like a real round of applause for the whole panel. Wonderful. I'm learning a lot. That was one of my great excitements coming to this summit, how much I'm going to learn, and right from the start, that's what's happening, and I hope all of you feel the same. The first question that I'm going to ask the panel, each of you to respond to if you have something you feel you would really like to contribute, starts with the observation that this summit is occurring at one snapshot in time, and the landscape is changing quickly. What's the most promising thing kind of on the horizon related to integrated primary care, and particularly in concern with international models of providing integrated care? And if you could provide an example of who's doing it, what's being done, kind of what you see as an exciting next step. So, and you want to start? Lovely.
So I would say I think of two things that come to mind. One is that people are really thinking about what local resources they have in terms of human resources. And we're seeing in the studies we're supporting a real variety of folks who are being used to deliver mental health interventions. So one example is work that's happening in Pakistan and India for managing maternal depression that Atif Rahman and Vikram Patel are leading. And they're using peers. So they're using moms who may have had an experience with depression or not to deliver a CBT-like intervention to women with perinatal depression. They've also worked with community health workers, but one of the challenges is, of course, community health workers in many settings are tasked with many, many, many responsibilities, and I think this is a challenge in low and middle income settings, is to see how much can people actually manage, how much can you manage and still deliver quality care. So I think what's interesting to me is to see how folks are using what's in their local environment and figuring out in different communities what kinds of providers are acceptable to deliver mental health services. And I guess the other thing is technology, that people are beginning to use smartphones in creative ways. The colleagues who are working in Peru and in Brazil are getting a nurse who is responsible for depression care, hypertension care, diabetes management, to guide patients in the use of an app that takes them through a sort of cognitive behaviorally a cognitive behaviorally type intervention on a smartphone. But then they have the opportunity to check in with the nurse from time to time.
Lovely. And I think, Shilin, you had mentioned some peer work too. You may want to comment on it or something else. Feel free.
Okay, yeah. I think drive me to think about integrative care is a very simple idea. Why I want to be very popular psychiatrist in our city. That's a very simple, but with this very strong stigma for Chinese to see a doctor, psychiatrist. I don't want to see a psychiatrist. I just want to see hypertension doctor. So integrative care can help us to overcome the stigma, especially working with the primary care physician together to think about if you send the patient to the primary care station, he think it's okay. If we send a patient to see a psychiatrist, especially for older adults, maybe they don't want to do that. So integrative care model is very important for older adults. And I also think about not just for the community resource, I'm thinking about the young generation. So I'm working in the psychology department. I train a lot of undergraduate students. So I'm teaching them community psychology to think about not just stay in the classroom, stay in the university. You have to move your body into the community to think about what kind of thoughts in the community. Yeah.
Great.
I think that one of the most important thing that I at least see is that the understanding that mental health problems are normal reactions to unnormal events in life and not biological or something that just goes on inside your brain is a change that is important, I think, to what we can achieve in integrated care or in care at all. Because then if you have the understanding that this is a biological disease and the disease model, the medical disease model for understanding mental health has been very strong. And I think that what I'm seeing now is that there's a development away from that towards a better model to understand and also then help people. And I think that opens up to other professions taking part in this, other professions and a real integration of different professions to work on mental health issues.
Great. And one more question for the panel, and then we'll open it up to your questions, so be thinking about what you want to ask. The second question for the panel, how can we best incorporate patient perspectives in the evolution of integrated primary care? I think Dr. Holder referred to this, and to really, listening to what people are looking for and patients want in their care.
So I think one way is actually getting peers involved in care and enabling those people who have the lived experience of mental illness to be part of care teams. And certainly, I mean, this may sound obvious, but listening to patients, listening to people that come to care and asking them what's working for them and what's not working for them.
Yeah, for me, I think from our practice, I think psychoeducation still very powerful and very important to get a patient in. And in my practice, we use PHQ-Net to do the screen, but the first question not about what's your mood or what's your interest, is what about insomnia, sleep disorder? That's very hopeful for older adults in China. Think about if I have sleep disorder, maybe I have mood disorder, something like that. If you ask them, do you have depression, maybe don't answer your question.
So asking about insomnia, which doesn't have the same stigma, can start the conversation.
Right.
Great.
Well, I think that what we saw in Norway was that during this, we had a 10-year period where we had a reform that was developed for, that was implemented for mental health in Norway. And during those 10 years, it was also funding to associations and user organizations. That was one part of the plan to get the user organization really working. And the board that I am chairing for this mental health in mental health in Norway is actually a joint organization with the user groups, the professions, and the universities together in one organization, trying to get mental health better in Norway and inform the public about mental health. So it's a collaboration between all of us, and that works very well. And we really want to sell that model to others as well.
Yeah, sounds wonderful. Well, what other questions do you have for this panel? The microphone's here. And as with the last, if you would introduce yourself and then ask the question.
Yeah, thank you. Wilson Pace from the University of Colorado and the Dartnet Institute. And, one of the, I'm finding it fascinating, integrated behavioral health by fiat. It's a great idea. But in this country, at least, we found that just because you're trained as a physician, you don't think like a primary care physician. And just because you're trained in behavioral mental health, you don't really think like integrated. How are you going to deal with the training needs when you have this kind of massive push all of a sudden? Do you feel like Norway is ready to take that on?
It's a very good question. We had a meeting only last week where we had universities that are educating psychologists in Norway talk about why they need to change how they educate psychologists, because we are not really there yet. But what I do, what my message is often, is that we learn a lot as psychologists already that are very, that is very useful also in the integrated care system. What we lack in Norway, at least now, and what I think many people lack, is the is during the education, we have an integrated education model where we have practice during our education. And all of that practice is now in secondary care. And of course, it needs to be in primary care, it needs to be in these teams. But the Minister of Health was actually at our meeting last week, and he said, well, we need all of you to apply for these positions. And he and I agree with him that we are really trained for this already, but we need to have practice places, we need to have practice training there. And that is the way forward, because we know this. We know how to do a lot of this already.
Other comments? Okay. Okay, here and then over here.
Hi, I'm Nancy Reddy from McCann Health. And I wanted to ask you, one of the things that's become abundantly clear to me here in the U.S. is that even though I think everyone in this room believes to the soles of their feet that integrated care is the way to go, integrated care has grown up in different silos, even within the United States. So you have people who come from departments of psychiatry, from family medicine, from the DOD, from the VA. And each model is just a little bit different, has different ideas about what's most important and so on. Although I think we're all kind of convening towards something in the center. But I think that has been a challenge for us to join together and create the kind of sea change that you've created in Norway and in other countries as well. So I wanted to get the panel's reflections on how do we de-silo ourselves as supposed experts in integration to help all of us swim in the same direction and be stronger as a group.
As a psychiatrist, as my practice is some difficult to work with primary care physician, talk about mental health issue special, for them they have no any formal training in China. Most primary care physician don't have any mental health training, but I think a relationship should be first the important things components. So we talk more about practice, talk about if some physician trying to transfer patient to me, that's okay. But we try to transfer back to practice, to primary care practice, because now in China, most primary care physician can transfer patient to the psychiatrist, to another doctor in the high hospital, but we don't do the transfer back. That's terrible. So in my practice, we transfer back to the primary care physician, let him see the whole process of the treatment. I think that's a very strong relationship building.
I'm going to agree with you about how difficult it is. I think in many of the settings where we're working, where people are attempting to integrate mental health into maternal child care services, into primary care services, they're finding that those services are even more siloed than they thought before they moved in. So we think, oh, everyone goes to, most women go to maternal child care services, but those are actually quite separate from general primary care services. So it's not an easy question. And another complication comes with donor funding, because many of these programs are being funded by specific donors who have given the program directors very explicit instructions on what can or cannot be included in a program. So the integration is often something that can happen, but maybe with limitations. I think South Africa may be a good example of a country that's, they're introducing universal health care and actually trying to train a cadre of providers that are providing chronic care across a number of disorders. That's underway. I think the story still will have to be told as to what are the bumps in the road that they can expect as they try to integrate this. But certainly some of it's going to have to do with siloed funding for different kinds of programs, and how does one, even if a government has mandated something, how does one still work across those silos? So a challenge.
Just a short comment. I think that, of course, as I said, Norway has a public health system, so it is easier, because when you talk about funding, that is always a driving force. But as you have a public health system, I think a lot comes back to leadership, and maybe that is also what it does in many other countries, that the people who are actually leading the services need to be thinking differently of what they do and what their responsibilities are. And I think that we see good examples in Norway of leaders in the secondary care system, in the primary care system, in the different services that agrees we have the same person in front of us, and we need to help this person. And then they have actually managed to make teams that are integrated from the child protection service, from the school service, from the health service, that actually work together. So, but that has to do with leadership more than anything, I think.
But I think it also has to do with country income.
Yes.
So Norway is not receiving a lot of development aid.
No, we don't. Exactly.
So that makes a difference.
Yes.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Yates Conroll from the University of Rochester. I'm a geriatric psychiatrist and run the Office for Aging, and have had the privilege of working with Shulin and other colleagues in China for many years. My question, probably primarily for Dr. Collins, but the others as well, is kind of a different version of that last. It's about the aging worker in our work. It's about peers. It's about the indigenous resources within the community. What we know and what we need to know about how to most effectively engage them. Because that's not a simple process either. There's a lot of anxiety about people kind of seeing themselves or redefining themselves as part of a healthcare system for a lot of different reasons. For many years, I worked with community-based social service agencies, aging agencies in the Rochester region, and we would go in there and we'd see that virtually that depression was ubiquitous in the clients that the aging services networks managed. And we said, well, what do you make of this? Is depression something that you work with frequently with your older people? And they said, no, it's not a problem. And we asked, dig a little bit, and it's not a problem. Why? Well, everybody's depressed. Then you go the next level, why don't they work with that? It's because they're really very anxious about asking the question because they feel so disconnected. And they feel so disconnected in part because they don't feel like they have a method by which to communicate effectively with primary care providers and so on and so forth. Our work in Zhejiang, one of our biggest challenges that we have to work very hard at is actually convincing these aging workers whom we want to engage as part of a system of integrated care that they can actually make a contribution because their differential with the health system is so stark historically. So how do we get over that?
Good question. No, I think that's a. I think people are dealing with that everywhere. I mean, what's the relation of lay health workers to the health system is something that folks are dealing with. In some countries, some of the experiences that we are learning about, this has become a real force of empowerment for those people in the communities who have some bit of status because they've been selected by the community to be these lay health workers. In other settings, it may not be that way. In other settings, those lay health workers are actually beginning to think, oh, we'd actually like a career path, and how can you begin to integrate us more formally into the healthcare system, and is there a way that we can move from being perhaps volunteers to paid community health workers, and can we become nurses, or what might be the next step for us? So I think it really depends on the dynamics of a given community and what the meaning is of these roles, and what the meaning, and maybe even the meaning of being an elder in a community is something to explore in these contexts. And you would certainly know more about that than I would.
Yeah, it's challenging for us to think about engage the aging worker or other communities we call community workers into our program. But I agree with you, in my practice, we try to use empowerment that may be useful for theory to think about.
I think one more question.
Hi, I'm Renad Batis from the University of Pennsylvania. That was a great presentation from all of you. One of the things I'm really interested in thinking about is how to apply the great lessons learned from the work that you all have been doing globally to domestic work here. And one of the really exciting disruptive innovations that you all have talked about is task shifting. And having lay workers following up on this line of inquiry that different people have been asking about. Could you speak a little bit to how that model might be implemented here? Because there's certainly challenges to having lay individuals implement mental health treatments here domestically with guild issues and all sorts of things. So I was just wondering if you might talk a little bit about how that might be implemented domestically.
I want to make clear that task shifting doesn't necessarily mean lay health workers. That can mean a primary care doctor. It can mean any kind of professional that's not a mental health specialist. So I think primary care doctors that are treating depression in their practices are also an example of task shifting. Collaborative care models are good examples of task shifting with a care coordinator who may not be a mental health specialist in some settings. So I think it's doable, but you're right. It's a lot more. I think the more resources you have, the more complicated it becomes to negotiate who should play which part in delivering care. But I don't think that's necessarily a problem. I think it's probably going to look different in different communities across the United States based on what the resource availability is and how practices can work this out. I think one more thing. In the U.S., certainly, outside of mental health, we've been using community health workers for a long time in other areas of healthcare, and particularly in minority communities and communities where people have tried to find folks who have a better knowledge of the community and can do great outreach to people in need of healthcare services. So, I guess my thinking is that in a country that has a lot of resources, we have more models to choose from, and one can think about what the best fit is in a given setting.
And actually, there was a question. He was first? Okay, thank you. Sorry. You're keeping good track. Thank
Being
you.
Back in the back of the room is not an advantage here. My name is David Morrow. I'm from Indiana University School of Medicine, but I'm representing the American Diabetes Association. I wanted to follow up on something Dr. Chin said, because it certainly resonated with my experience. We're talking about integrated healthcare and organizing a lot of professionals and paraprofessional folks, but we haven't talked too much about the patient and selling this to the patient. And as you mentioned, stigma is a huge issue. And in my system, a lot of people don't want to take advantage of a new system. It's like, we're going to offer you something different. We're going to integrate new things. We're going to show you different people. And they go, no, I don't want to do that. And so I'm curious what all of your experience is about the selling of this, if you will, to the patient base.
And we talk about the patient because in our model, we use the primary care physician to do the practice, and in their idea is also is patient center. So, but in our program, we actually use lot of community resources. In that resource, we don't use patient; we use just older adults, because that's most of our psych education and the health education program activities start in the community center. We call people in the community center and give them a talk and give some physical examination, and we just talk about the patient, we talk about disease, talk about sleep disorder, something like that. So, but in our model, we use the patient.
I think that it's a very good question. I was quoted for, my most famous quote in Norway was when I said that we should have psychologists at IKEA. That could be for many reasons, but the point was, of course, that being where everyone else is the point. And this idea came from, I visited a step care center in the UK, where they have placed the step care center at the football stadium. Everyone who they wanted to reach, they wanted to reach adult males, and they placed the center at the football stadium. And because they then pass there every day, and at some point they might say, well, I might go in there when I go somewhere because that was where they were. And I also think that what we see the psychologists and the teams are doing with psychologists are doing in Norway, they go to the opening day at school, and they have 2 hours talking to parents and children about how should the school year be, what will be the best thing to do to get a good school environment, and they talk about this to everyone, and that also opens up to, oh, this is we can go here. These people are not dangerous. This is not mental illness. This is mental health, which also helps, I think.
There's a great example, some great examples in the U.S. around community engagement. So actually, getting communities to first educating communities about mental health, mental health care. Ken Wells has done some really nice work in the Los Angeles area, working with community partners to engage communities, listen to their understanding of what they need in terms of mental health services, figuring out who do people in these communities utilize for not just mental health care, because people aren't usually going to mental health services, but who do they utilize for social services, primary care, other forms of support, and how can those people be brought into the circle as well to help deliver mental health interventions, or at least refer them to mental health interventions. But that really took a lot of organized community engagement effort.
Great. So, time for one more question, or do we need to wrap up? Okay, great. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.